I had a pretty good day at the thrift store today. I got this temperature and humidity thing for $1.91. It's nice to have that humidity scale on it. Got this alternative hits CD for 99 cents, including Closing Time by Semisonic. Got this ground loop isolator with RCA jacks on it for $2.49. Got a Win TV card, PCI card, for $2.99 or $2.49. I can't really read it. And finally, this little Sanjian radio. I've seen these in the C. Crane catalog. It's the DT-110. It's not the best of their little pocket-sized radios, but it's pretty good. So, look forward to giving that a try. Got that for $2.42. It was in the display case, which makes me wonder why they even bothered putting it in there when it was so cheap. They also had a tube-type AM clock radio from the 1960s, but it needed new capacitors. I plugged it in, turned it on, and it came to life, but it made a loud humming noise, even with the volume control turned all the way down. So that's the sign that it needed new caps, so I didn't bother with it. They also had a Sony clock radio that was so cheap, it was FM only. It's the first clock radio I've seen which was FM only. It was the ICF C201. And they also had a large console, black and white round tube TV from the 1950s. But the price tag was $299.99. Yes, that's $300 for a console TV in unrestored condition. It was in pretty good shape. The cabinet was reasonably good. It had some chips and stuff on it, but it was okay. It was missing the badge, so I didn't even know what brand name it was. And it was missing the back, so you could just look in and see the picture tube and everything. I might grab this camcorder and take it in next time I'm here just to see if it's still there, just to give you a quick view of that. So that was my Saturday at the thrift store. I forgot to mention that at the thrift store there was also a Canon PowerShot digital 3.3 megapixel camera for 10 bucks, and it looked in good condition, but I didn't get it because it requires a special type of lithium battery and also a compact flash card. Those are two things I don't have, so I figured it wasn't really worth it for me. Especially since that other camera I got there recently works just fine. That's the one that takes SD cards and standard AA batteries, which makes it a lot more convenient for me. Here's what that Sony clock radio looked like. It was just really strange seeing if only the FM band on the tuner and no AM. It is an official Dream Machine. It's also part of Sony's Psych series that they had for a while. But just really, really cheap clock radio. Also at the thrift store was one of these Pioneer 18-disc CD changers. There's 3 6-disc magazines, although it only came with one magazine. And it was stuck in. I was hitting the eject button and it wasn't coming out. So it seemed like it was broken. Also did not include the remote. Here's a closer look at that Win TV card made by Hop Hog Computer Works. It says 280000-02, copyright 2003. Uses a Conexant broadcast decoder CX23880-19. And a Conexant MPEG-2 AV encoder, CX23416-12. It's a little bit discolored around the voltage regulator on both sides, so obviously has been used quite a bit. Hopefully it still works fine, though. On the back, it has inputs for FM, which is nice. I did not know it had FM radio. Wonder if it has RDS. TV input, which would be analog TV only, S video input, composite video input, and left and right stereo audio. So it's nice it has regular jacks on the back instead of needing a special cable. Has this pin out here, probably for a front panel connector, which I did not get with it. But not bad for less than $3. And I found this Sea Crane catalog from 2002. And right on page 12 is the Sanjian DT110. Same model as this, except this one says Discovery Channel on it. They say reception is almost as good as the DT200V, which they claimed as the best AM reception of any pocket radio made. I did try it out on FM. It's really nothing special. Sensitivity is okay, but selectivity is not very good. So if you live in an area with a crowded FM band with a lot of stations on adjacent channels, you'll end up with stations overlapping each other. On AM, it does pretty good. Bandwidth is reasonably okay. It's not very wide band, but it sounds okay. And sensitivity is pretty good, so not bad. Definitely not the best ever made, but decent performing radio on AM. And on FM, it's okay. It's pretty typical for a Walkman-sized tuner on FM. I noticed the AM antenna is actually facing this way. So normally the radio sort of aims in the direction of the station. Well, you have to aim it like this to aim it towards a certain station, because it appears that the loopstick antenna is facing this way inside it. Came with batteries that work, which is nice. And on the top is the power button. You get your tuning, band, AM or FM, mono or stereo for FM. Obviously it's not AM stereo. Headphone output, bass boost switch, which also boosts the treble a little bit, volume control, and a lock control, which is good because this is easy to turn on just by hitting the top, so you might want to put the lock on. So if you're carrying it in your pocket or something, it doesn't accidentally get turned on. It came with this vinyl cover, which gives you a cutout for the screen and little engravings where the buttons go so you can feel them. And one on the top for the power button. On the back is a belt clip. And this side is open for connecting your headphones and reaching the volume control. It also says Discovery Channel, so this might have been some kind of special promotional thing. Original price for the radio itself in the catalog was $49.95. It's another day, another thrift store. We'll see what's at this one, if there's anything good.
Center Sunday on ESPN.
Well, a lot of interesting stuff in the store, but only thing I ended up getting is this Road and Track magazine from May 1981, featuring the Datsun 280ZX Turbo. Lots of nostalgia in there. Old cars of the early 80s. The J cars. That was brand new back then. The Chevy Cavalier and the Pontiac and Buick and Oldsmobile versions. So, I had a lot of fun looking through these. An ad for the Mercedes 240D. I had one of those. It was a 1981, in fact. And even back then, it cost $20,000. And so, a lot of neat stuff in there. And also this 1995 new car report. And it's very high quality. It's not one of those cheap little paperbacks. It's, you know, glossy paper, full color photos of all these new cars from 1995. All different models, pickup trucks, sports cars, luxury cars, domestic cars. So, a lot of neat stuff. Pretty much everything that was on the market in 1995 is in this book. So it's a nice throwback to the 1990s. Well, there's the Passat. They didn't have the TDI yet in 1995. They only had the VR6. But that was new for 1995, this body style. That's actually the Cadillac version, the ill-fated Cimarron, that was widely reviewed negatively for being too cheap to be a real Cadillac. They also say the Buick and Oldsmobile versions were not going to be coming out until 1983. This was back when motor oil was sold in cans instead of bottles. And even included these original cards in it. Subscription would cost $7.97 for a year. Here's an ad for the Audi 4000. Advertising 41 miles per gallon on the highway, although that was before they changed the standards to reduce the mileage ratings. So that would be, by today's standards, that would be probably the lower to mid 30s by the current EPA standards of the same vehicle. And that's back when Audis were sold at Porsche dealers. It was the dealers were combined Porsche and Audi. The Renault Le Car, sold by American Motors. Chevrolet Citation X11 with a V6 engine, carbureted. 135 horsepower, 4-speed manual transmission. They even have an article about Super 8 film cameras and the early video cameras and portable VCRs. They mentioned Beta and VHS. So I didn't take home any electronics today, but I did get some nice reading material about cars from early 1980s and mid-1990s.